As I get started, I'll mention that the arborists who care for trees were members of the International Society of Arboriculture. We have a Texas chapter as well, and so those arborists are certified through that organization. But I'll go a step further and say that there's different specialized trainings that arborists can go through to do certain assessments. So there's a tree hazard assessment training that several of our arborists went through that that assists with doing a very thorough evaluation of a tree. And so I will caution you on not thinking you're an expert after the presentation, that I would encourage you to consult with the arborist if you're concerned about a tree, or if you see one in the community that maybe is overlooked by someone, especially the property owner, that you take a moment to let them know. I try to do that when I can, when I'm out doing appointments. If I see a tree, I try to get in touch with that owner, because I do kind of have an obligation as an arborist to, when I see things that are hazardous, to let people know. Sometimes those trees are in our HOA common areas or parks. Yesterday I was visiting a client that was HOA representative. They wanted to see about removing a tree that is affecting one of their brick walls. Well, it turns out the tree is a hazardous tree to begin with, and the whole thing should have been taken out probably a while ago. So I'm going to talk about hazardous trees, but we should also talk about what is a healthy tree and how do we maintain the health of a tree, because we shouldn't lose sight of that, because we don't want our trees to become hazardous. So how can we prevent that? And so tree health is dependent on several factors. These organisms need access to soil, good soil, the soil that's those plants are adapted to, water, sufficient water, not too much, not too little, the proper amount of nutrients. And in many cases, our trees may not be able to access the nutrients in our soil because of the pH, because they're not adapted to our soil pH and therefore cannot extract it from the soil. Iron is one of those that we commonly see. Trees that aren't native to this area may not be adapted to high pH soils like we have here. And then those trees can die from that, just from years of lack of iron. So we as an industry can inject iron into a tree to temporarily correct that deficiency. That's just an example. Obviously they need air. Not just air, say CO2 in the atmosphere, but also oxygen in the soil. That's something that's often overlooked for plants. It is a common problem in our soil too, because it's a heavy clay soil that has very tight pore spaces, and then oxygen cannot penetrate deep into the soil because the pore spaces are so small. Clay soil has the smallest particle size, and therefore the pore spaces are very small. And so there's just not a lot of oxygen. So what we find is a lot of our plants, including our trees, the roots are very shallow because they cannot access oxygen deeply in the soil. Sunlight is important. You know, we're looking at a tree here at a park, but you know, at some point it was a forest, and those trees competed for light. They compete for light in our landscapes as well. Some trees are adapted to shade, and we should realize that. One tree that we often see problems with sun damage is a Japanese maple that is adapted as an understory tree and needs some shade, especially in the afternoon. We need a tree needs space too to try to achieve its mature size. And then the proper temperature range throughout the different seasons. So this tree that we see in the picture is the bicentennial bur oak at Bob Woodruff Park near the South Pavilion. It's estimated this tree is about 450 years old. So it's considered the oldest living thing here in North Texas. It's not the champion bur oak, but it is certainly a contender. Champion trees are the largest trees of its species in a given area. So we want to try to protect this tree. So this tree is in a floodplain. The park is floods regularly, so that it is an issue for the tree, but certainly 450 years of flooding, it survived those. I would say the biggest concern I have as an arborist for it is compaction from foot traffic from all the visitors that come to visit the tree. It was recognized as a bicentennial bur oak because it was considered to be around during the 200-year anniversary of our Constitution. So it's one of my favorite trees. So a healthy tree has an ideal structure. It has an expansive root system, proper branches, branch spacing is what it should say, strong branching angles, which we'll talk about more, an expansive canopy spread to capture that sunlight. So sunlight is where that energy comes from, and trees and other plants capture that sunlight energy and convert it to chemical energy, which it uses to create new cells, to grow, to store that energy as well. So this tree is one of our champion chinkapin oaks, and this is in McKinney. This is Mike Seals with the Forest Service. We're doing a measurement of the tree. And you might wonder, why is he pulling the tape out from the tree? Well, we're actually measuring the height of the tree. So we go out a certain distance, a measurable distance, and then we use a sighting device to actually measure the height of it. So so this is a client of ours, and we are caring for the tree. There's actually co-champions next to each other. So, and they're very beautiful trees. They were almost bulldozed one morning by the developers of this neighborhood. But fortunately, the homeowner had the courage to go up there and stand in front of the bulldozer to prevent it from taking down these trees. So we need advocates for trees, especially our historic trees that have been around a long time. Why am I even talking about this? Well, we need to look to our historic trees as an example of what they need, what are ideal growing conditions, how have they survived this long, and then for our own trees, try to mimic those conditions. So we also have to think about the location. Not every location is ideal for a tree to be healthy. It needs to have those matching soil properties for that species. It should have a deep soil profile. And then proper nutrient cycling within that soil. So when we plant grass, particularly grass, because that's what we deal with most in urban environments, under the tree, that's not really a natural situation for that tree. And so we have to think about the fact that it may not be getting the nutrients that it needs. There are ways to kind of overcome that. Obviously, not everyone's willing to take out the grass under a tree, but adding, say, compost on an annual basis as a top dressing through in your grass, that can help to maintain a high organic matter in the soil. We need good drainage. Some species are adapted to poor drainage, like a bald cypress is adapted to a swamp, but they're planted in people's yards. I'm not saying I agree with that, but let's see, proper water infiltration rates. So that is a soil property that we need to consider. So sometimes our soils may have problems and the water does not infiltrate into the soil very well. A clay soil is not going to do that naturally because the pore spaces are very tight. But if we are encouraging a healthy soil, typically with organic matter like compost and mulch, we can increase the rate that that soil infiltrates into the soil. Aerating the soil is really important. So that you may say, well, you want to aerate around a tree, wouldn't you damage the roots? Yes, that's something you need to consider. Most people, when they think of aerating, they think of aeration of a lawn, which is quite dramatic, I guess, in comparison to what we do. We use deep root fertilization, which we use an injector that we inject down to a foot, and we do it under high pressure, which helps to aerate the soil. It's an industry-wide standard. And then access to water, obviously. So another component of how trees can survive is for a long time is protection from fire. So that you know, typically nowadays we don't think of fire. Obviously out in California and out west, they have more problems with wildfires. In an urban environment, we don't seem to be concerned too much about that. But when we think of some of the older trees that have survived a long time, they had some protection from fire, either because they were adapted to that or they were protected in some other way. Droughts, so protection from droughts. Typically those trees that have lived a long time are near creeks and floodplains. That's how they survive droughts, because they had access to water when other trees didn't. But we have to consider that in our landscapes by protecting our trees from drought stress. We during the early part of this decade, we lost lots, millions of trees across Texas because of the drought. Floods, obviously, erosion is becoming more of an issue. Especially in our landscapes, as those trees mature, you can't grow the grass that was originally planted, and that water is running off your roof, under the tree, washing away the soil. Wind and then lightning, which we'll talk more about later. So just to kind of review, it's best to maintain the health of the tree rather than trying to correct a problem. Many times problems, it's very challenging and takes a long time to try to correct a problem once it surfaces or is obvious. Improving the health of the soil is the best way to improve the health of the tree. So using compost and mulch are the best ways to maintain the soil health. And if we can maintain the soil health, we can maintain the health of the tree. So deep soil aeration is important to provide roots with oxygen, as I mentioned. And so we use deep root fertilization, but also vertical mulching, which is a little bit different and tends to be more extensive. We do, in a way, vertical mulch by using the deep root fertilization method, but vertical mulching tends to be more substantial. So basically we're digging a hole in the soil. Typically it's done with an air spade, which is a digging device that uses air to dig with. And then we fill that hole up with mulch or compost and therefore aerate the soil and keep that that kind of hole accessible to air, to allow air to enter and penetrate the soil more deeply. And water can go in there too, allow water to infiltrate deeper in the soil. It's been shown these two methods are extremely helpful in helping trees that are sick, so to speak, recover from those problems. But the key thing is regular inspection, pruning, fertilization, and that's all part of tree health care programs. So as a reminder, look to our historic trees for examples of how they grow and how they survive such a long time. So this is considered the oldest live oak in North Texas. It's just north of downtown Dallas. It's at one of those large estates off Preston Road. It has been recognized by the Forest Service. I believe it's the champion for the Metroplex, champion live oak for the Metroplex. So you notice the growth pattern on this tree. It grows all the way down towards to the ground. I'm taking this photo from inside the canopy of the tree. So if you look at it from the outside, it looks like this massive bush, but it took a lot of courage from the owners of this house, which have lived there for generations, to not over prune this tree. And another example of what this tree had available to it was space that a lot of our trees don't have in a residential environment. Okay, now we'll get into the topic on hazardous trees. And it's important to note some key things. All trees have the potential to fail or fall, however you would like to say it, given the right conditions. So even a tree that appears to be healthy has the potential to fail. And so there's risk associated with every tree, but it varies. So when we make assessments of trees, we're looking at those factors that can increase the risk. And that may be the species itself could be considered more, have a higher risk just because of known issues that it has. The growth habit, defects in that tree, quality of branch attachments, condition of the root system, if a tree has a lean to it, history of the tree and the site, and this is all from the International Society of Arboriculture. Trees, or parts of a tree, that fail when the load they experience exceeds the structural capacity. So we see a large bur oak in an older neighborhood in Fort Worth. I took this picture last year, and the homeowner has experienced the loss of several cars from this tree because those are massive branches. And I think the client said that she's lost 3 cars in a year from the branches falling out. And unfortunately, my uncle, who's been looking at this tree since the 1970s, said that it's gone now. It ended up falling partly on the house, and the insurance company ended up paying to remove it. We did give a proposal to remove the tree, but the client couldn't afford it because it was so expensive. We would have to get a large crane to come in and help with that removal. So tree risk assessments consider 3 factors: the potential for the tree to fail, the environment may contribute to that failure. If the tree fails, what would be damaged? And we consider that the target. So when we're evaluating these trees, if they're out in the open, away from everything, the risk is relatively low because the frequency of someone or something being underneath that tree or be near the tree if it were to fail is low. So then the risk is low. But obviously a tree that's near the house or near a sidewalk, near a street or near a driveway, that if it fails, it could fall on it. That it greatly increases the risk. The biggest risk is a dead tree. So this is a tree that we removed last August, and it had been dead for probably 6 months. It's a large post oak up near Lake Texoma. And it took our crews all day to remove. And so that's a high risk. And even a tree like this, if it's allowed to stand dead for a long period of time, it can become dangerous for our crews or anybody to climb to remove it. Fortunately, the main trunk of the tree was still sound and our crews were able to climb it and piece it down. But when they were cutting these branches and they would fall on the ground, they just would shatter into lots of pieces because they were just been dead and rotten so much. So that's a big factor that sometimes people don't understand, that if a tree dies, you need to get it down as soon as possible. The longer it stands there, the more hazardous it becomes. And obviously, if a tree's dead, you know it needs to come down. Other factor is dead branches. So some species naturally produce dead branches potentially every year. And if they're not removed, they accumulate within the canopy of the tree and it can become very dangerous. And that's more of a maintenance, tree maintenance, pruning program is needed. So this is a large dead branch. So you may ask, well, how do you know if it's dead or not? Particularly in the growing season, if it doesn't have leaves, that's an easy way to find out. When the tree would be naturally dormant and you're trying to identify those dead branches, if it doesn't have any buds on the twigs, then it's likely dead. In this case, there's a fungus growing on the bark of the tree, so it was a sign that this tree was dead. There's a longer story about this tree that I'll get into later. So structural problems, these are things that we try to correct with pruning, cabling, and bracing. So something that I regularly specify in pruning programs is structural pruning. Because there's always a little bit of structural pruning that a tree would need. And that's removing, essentially rubbing and crossing branches. It could be removing branches that have a poor branch angle. So a branch that has a very tight angle or V-shaped crotch in the tree would and should need to be considered to be removed. Because that's not a strong branch angle. It should have more of a U shape. Dead branches should be taken off as part of structural pruning. So this is just an example of regular pruning would solve some of these structural problems. So some structural defects. Codominant stems. These would be stems or trunks where you have multiples. In the case on the right, there's three growing together. And this is an American elm over in Lucas Parker area. The tree is essentially dying, but slowly. So when a tree grows together like that, basically the bark from each of those stems is actually growing and pushing each other apart as it grows in girth. So it increases the chance that that tree would split. In the case on the left there, that's a Chinese pistache. It is very common for those to have multiple branches from a single point. And that tree actually split, and a client wanted to put it back together. And that's something that we do, and we call that bracing. So We drill holes through those branches and then put threaded rods through and then bolt it together. We also have to add cables up in the canopy to help hold that together. So that's something the tree will live with. In most cases, the trees survive that process of installing those that hardware, and the tree can continue to live. So these Kodama stems do develop bark inclusions, or what we call included bark. This is a good example. This is a tree in Allen, and this is a live oak. And they handle these bark inclusions fairly well, but in this case, this tree developed a substantial bulge on the side of the tree where that bark is being included or being grown together, and it's so much force is pushing it out the side. Some trees don't do that. They just, it starts a point of decay where the bark's growing towards each other, and it basically kills that tissue and it stops growing. In this case, it's just pushing those cells out to the side. So this is a hackberry. This is over in Lucas. So this was farmland, and then the house was built on the land. It's a probably 5 or 10 acre lot. So the client called and said they had a large branch that broke in a storm. And you can see that this was had an included bark area or bark inclusion. So this would be the area of the inclusion. And you see that the decay started to spread within this area. And you can actually see roots that started to grow because that area trapped material that would accumulate in that crotch of that branch. And roots started to grow in there. But it broke off, and this creates a large wound. Obviously, we took the branch off, but this wound is going to be a point of decay that'll spread in that tree. Some species of trees tolerate those decay better. It's what we call compartmentalization of decay, or CODIT is the acronym. But hackberries are notorious for not being very good at that. And therefore, the tree will become unsafe fairly quickly just because that decay will spread. So there are two species of hackberries. There's sugarberry and a hackberry, and we see both of those in our region. However, very few people can identify or be able to separate the difference between the two. The sugarberry actually is a better tree than the hackberry. And so that's one reason why I point that out. So another bark inclusion, this is a elm tree. A little bit different situation, very large tree. The stem on the left was growing over the roof of the house. And then during an inspection, we noticed this area of decay where the bark started to fall off, and that was all very soft wood that had already been decayed. And so we did one of these hazardous tree evaluations on it, and provided that information to the client. And based on that assessment, they decided to remove the tree just because it was unsafe and it was hazardous. So I point this out because this is a cedar elm that I happened to catch a squirrel in the crack. And this was a bark inclusion that had split. And we're out checking on the trees at this area in this neighborhood. And the squirrel was hiding from me in there. So it's pretty cute, but squirrels are actually pretty bad for trees. And I show an example of some damage that they've done to this tree on the right. And you can see their claw mark from where they've been scratching and chewing. And so they kill, I wouldn't say they kill a lot of trees, unless it's a small tree, but they do kill a lot of branches. So I'm sorry I'm focusing on this so much, on the bark inclusions, but it is something that you can identify very easily, and it does increase the risks and hazard. And I'm routinely recommending cabling for trees, not just bracing, because bracing is only really used if the tree's cracked. And so we can just install a cable to help strengthen those branches and keep them together. And that might have actually saved this tree from splitting in half. This is a Bradford pear, and a very large one. And we ended up taking the whole tree down, just because the other side's still alive, but it just looks terrible. And it's all growing over the roof of the house. And so it's hazardous as well. So cracks, structural defects. There's a story behind this broken limb, because it happened while I was meeting with the client in front of the house. And we walked under that point a few minutes before, and we heard some crack and then a crash, yeah. And so this branch fell, and it could have hurt us, killed us, if we would have been standing there. It really speaks to the hazards that I'm talking about in this presentation, and it's something we need to be concerned about. However, there was no sign to me standing on the ground that would have given me any warning that branch would have broke. So that also scares you, in the fact that it can happen and you don't know. I'm limited by staying on the ground. I'm not a tree climber, but in some trees that we're evaluating, we do need to get one of our tree climbers out there, climb the tree to give a more close-up assessment of maybe a particular branch or a wound or a cavity. Honeybees love these cavities in trees, and so there's a season where honeybees swarm and then enter those cavities and set up a hive. And it's a natural process, but we need to also be concerned about what those cavities are like and be concerned about it. So one of the biggest things that concerns us is how improper pruning can alter the structure of a tree to make it unsafe. This is a client that I visited. You can't see it on this particular tree, but the tree next to it was, both trees were pruned improperly. And the tree on the right was actually dropping all its leaves, just from the stress that it had from over pruning. And so you may say, well, what's the over pruning? Was it just that they stripped out the bottom portion? Well, that is a factor, but in the next picture, you'll see that the tree was topped, and it was just completely topped. And all these branches here are actually sprouts. So it was topped right here on all these branches. And so then the trees, when they're overpruned, they try to recover the canopy, and they'll grow sprouts out of different places within the stem. This is a typical place where they would sprout, is near where that cut was made. But in some cases, they'll sprout all along that long branch. So what happens is, not only does this stress the tree out, but you can see in this picture that one of the sprouts previously broke and then ripped down the side. And within the canopy of the tree, there's a lot of examples of where the sprouts ripped down the side. So unfortunately, the client just hired someone who was driving around the neighborhood and said, let me prune your trees. And he said, okay,
and they did a terrible job. So it's better to hire someone who's has a reputation, that's has a certified arborist on staff, et cetera. So in a similar situation, this tree was over-pruned. On the left, you can see that large branches were cut off recently. So you can see large branches here. And on the picture on the right, you see over here, large branches were taken off. So the canopy, most of the canopy's up very, very high. The thing about leaving lower limbs on trees is that it helps to buffer the wind, and it actually protects the tree from the wind as well. So when those limbs are removed, it puts all the weight up at the top, and when it catches wind, the tree is exposed to a greater load from the wind. And what we also see is that it causes a twisting action on the tree's trunk and canopy. So this is not a positive thing, and you think, well, that's an awful large tree that was planted right between those two houses. Well, there are many neighborhoods in North Texas where trees, the houses were planted amongst the trees. And you know, that's a positive thing, saving trees. But this tree was right next to the foundation. It's growing into the foundation. I'm not sure that was a good candidate to save. There's more to the story on this tree, but I believe they ended up removing the tree. So, oh, another thing I wanted to say about that last picture was that branches that are closer to your roof are actually safer than having branches further from your roof. If you think about it, those larger branches, if they break, they gain speed as they come down. But if a branch is closer to your roof, it doesn't have any chance to gain speed, and it doesn't cause as much damage. So it's good to have roof clearance, and I normally recommend 4 to 6 feet. Rarely am I ever recommending more than that. So another structural defect that can occur is girdling roots. This is actually girdles the base of the tree and strangles it, and the tree can die from that. But it also can increase the chance the tree would snap at that point too. So this is a branch that was cabled at by our company at some point in the past, but for some reason, possibly hail damage, a large wound developed on the top surface of that branch, and decay has spread throughout that branch. And this is a tree that we just pruned yesterday. This is before pruning, obviously, but so a lot of weight had developed on the ends of these branches. When you have a situation where a tree is hazardous or branches are hazardous, it's important not to allow too much weight to develop on the ends of those branches, because that increases the weight that branch has to carry, and then therefore increases the chances that branch could break. So regular pruning is important to help prevent those branches from breaking. And some species are more known for developing a lot of weight on the ends of branches. Pecan trees are notorious for that. And primarily because if it produces nuts, then you have that seasonal load that pulls those branches down. And so over time, those branches kind of have a curvature to them. And they should be pruned to help manage that load. So I mentioned honeybees and cavities. This was the first time where I saw the honeycombs actually coming out of the cavity. So these are honeycombs coming out of the cavity. This is a large pecan tree And this is probably 40 or 50 feet in the air. So I thought it was cool, but it's certainly something to think about as a risk. If that cavity is large enough to have a substantial beehive, then it may not provide the structural integrity for that large branch. Disease, so that's my specialty as a plant pathologist. And so I get a little excited about this. But we get concerned about different symptoms. And cankers are one of the symptoms that we get concerned about. This is a bacterial canker on peach tree, which peach trees generally don't get so big that they become hazardous. But it's an example of, a more extreme example of bacterial canker. Hypoxylin canker is something we routinely see. It can be a little challenging to notice with the untrained eye because it produces spore mats on the surface of the bark. And those spore mats can change colors over time. So in this picture, these gray areas right here, those are the spore mats. In this case, they're black over here. Sometimes they're orange and different colors. So really it's black, orange, white is what we typically see. So certainly it's something you need to be aware of. This particular fungus can kill the tree over time. And there is no cure for it. Here's an example of hypoxylin canker that had rotten the base of a hackberry tree here in Fairview. You notice the black growth at the bottom of the tree right down here. You notice there's a large wound from a branch that had broken off and ripped down the side. That is one of the problems when a branch breaks. If it rips down the side, it creates this huge wound that may never heal. You can see the callus tissue. That's this tissue that's a bulge on the right and left side of that wound. The tree tried to heal itself, but because hackberries aren't very good at sealing those wounds, and the decay spread faster than the wound healed, that likely led to this hypoxylin canker rotting the base of the tree. So this was a client of ours. They called us with an emergency. We immediately came out and quoted a price for removal, and then I had a crew there later that day to get it removed. Fortunately, it didn't do too much damage to the roof of the house. It damaged some gutters, some shingles, and the fence. And fortunately, no one got hurt. One of the fungus that we're most concerned about is Ganoderma root rot. This is something that you would look for, is this conch at the base of a tree. It can be within the trunk of the tree, the root flare of the tree, and even the roots as well. And it is a fungus that's going to rot the tree around the base or the root system. It can change colors as well. Typically, it's this kind of orangish color when it's fresh. And then it turns to almost a dark brown to black color when it's done its business. So these are like mushrooms. They produce spores that spread in the wind. And the reason for the production of a conch or mushroom is that two mating types of the fungus are growing in the tree, and they come together and mate actually through sexual reproduction and then produce this mushroom or conch. And that's why you have those mushrooms produced. That's why in a, you know, these fairy rings that develop in lawns, it's because the fungus growing through the soil and then comes in contact with another mating type. So this is what we're worried about. So this is Ganoderma root and crown rot. This is from a master gardener in Dallas County. I was given a presentation about this particular, well, just diseases of trees. And she said, oh, that happened to my tree. And she told us the story. And then she sent me the photos. And as you can see, this tree had a full canopy and looked and appeared healthy, but obviously was not. And during a storm, it came down. And if you can see, this was all rotten down at the base. And this is the risk associated with that particular disease. So as arborists, when we're inspecting trees and we see a conk growing on it, we generally recommend to remove the tree because we don't know how extensive that decay is underground, and this could happen. So here we have an example of a wood decaying fungus. And in this case, a large cut was made here from probably a co-dominant stem, and that decay ended up spreading, and this fungus with it up through the tree. This is within 5 feet of the garage of a house, and because of the decay and this fungus growing on the surface, I recommended that the tree be removed. In addition, the client wanted to keep the tree after I recommended removal. And that's so we run into this quite often where someone wants to take the risk. And so I recommended that we take out a lot of the weight of the tree over the house so that if it were to fail, that it would likely fail away from the house. So sometimes the expense associated with the removal can prevent people from removing trees. And in some cases we recommend, and we always work with clients on their budget, that we could piece the tree down over a period of time so that it could be less expensive. And taking the weight out of the tree, you can reduce the risk associated with it too. Just another example of a tree that's showing signs of decay because it has fungus growing on the bark on the outside. The bark's cracking and some of it's falling off. This was in a median up in Frisco. More examples of fungi growing out of the bark. In this case, there's a large pecan tree on the right. Cut was made, and unfortunately that decay started to spread all through this area, which probably is about 6 to 8 feet off the ground, and the tree's probably 50 to 75 feet tall, so that is a critical portion of the tree for its strength, and it increases that risk that that decay may spread. Pecans generally are considered good compartmentalizers of that decay, so they prevent it from spreading. It's possible to do additional assessments on the trees with additional tools to determine how far that decay goes into the trunk of the tree. So this is pretty impressive gall on the base of a red oak. This is a crown gall caused by Agrobacterium tumefaciens. It's probably one of the largest galls I've seen. This is here in Dallas. This is one of my colleagues standing next to it. This tree is very tall, at least 75 feet tall. Over the years, they've been pruned pretty high too, so the canopy's mostly at the top. And as you can see on the picture on the right, that gall, that tissue, doesn't form in a normal manner and it doesn't have a lot of strength. And so potentially the interior of that trunk doesn't have a lot of strength. So in my opinion, that would increase the chance that that tree could fail. And there's evidence of decay within the gall too. So something else to think about. And more recently, I've noticed, I've identified some areas where crown gall is affecting root flares. In this case, this was a live oak that was planted too deep and somehow, probably through a wound of the root system, the bacteria entered and started causing this infection. The canopy of the tree was very thin. The client decided that to have it removed. So insects, one of the biggest concerns we have with insects is wood boring insects. Obviously, if it's boring in the wood, it can potentially reduce the structural strength of the wood, but also kill the tree. Generally speaking, we feel that wood borers attack trees that are stressed or weakened for some reason. That could be drought stress or maybe damage to the root system or the tree, and then therefore those weakened trees attract those insects. So in certain species, they can be present. So this is kind of shows their activity. We have a flat-headed wood borer on the right, and that's kind of how they move within the tree. Primarily, they're feeding on the cambium layer, which is the area between the bark and the wood. That's where new cells are made, and that's the most nutrient-rich area. And so then they produce these galleries. In some cases, those galleries have specific patterns that help you identify what type of borer it is. But here's the one that we're most concerned about right now. This is a new insect to the region. I was introduced from Asia into the Midwest and has devastated ash trees through that area. And within a few months ago, it was confirmed that it's present in northern Tarrant County. So it's expected to spread throughout North Texas and be devastating to our ash trees. So obviously this is gonna, it's expected to kill potentially all our ash trees that we have. It may take years for that to happen, but these borers attack healthy trees. So unfortunately there's not much we can do to prevent it, except currently there's an insecticide that can be injected into the tree to protect it from being infested by these insects. However, it's relatively expensive and you would have to do it at least every 3 years in order to protect it. Some areas are actually considering preemptively removing ash trees as a way to try to mitigate for the disease. One reason for that is that in the Midwest, the trees died so fast that they couldn't keep up with the tree removals. So there was a lot of dead trees standing. So construction injury and root disturbance is a very common problem in the urban environment. In this case, these are two bur oaks that were planted by the previous owner of this property, but then the property was sold to a developer and built into a shopping center. And you can see that it appears that they add a lot of soil on top around the base of those trees. You don't see any root flares. The trunk seems awful kind of low there. And you see that the tree is sprouted all along the the branches and it started to die back from the tips. At the time I took this photo, I didn't know who the owner was, but then he's a friend of a friend, and I was at his house working on his new house, working on his trees, and he told me the story about his trees, and so I was able to connect the dots. This is actually right by our office in Wiley. This is a client's house that hired a landscaper to work to install landscaping around some existing red oaks. But unfortunately, they didn't take precautions to protect the tree, and there's a lot of industry standards on how you would want to do that. In addition, a new landscaper requires a lot of water, and so then it was likely drowned by that amount of water, and the trees both died. So something I bring it up as a cautionary note that landscaping around the base of a tree is something that you should do with great care. And it'd be better to only have mulch around the base of a tree to help protect it. One of the big issues is irrigation. So the irrigation system was trenched through these roots as well. And I commonly see trees that struggle because a client hired an irrigation person who didn't know how to work around trees and went the shortest distance around the tree and cut roots very close to the trunk, and it was damaging the health of the tree. One way we can mitigate for construction injury is using our air spade. So this is a job we did last week. They're having their pool renovated, and they wanted to not lose their trees, and so they hired us to come in with our air spade, which is like this big air gun, and allows us to dig. Fortunately, around the pool, it was backfilled with mostly fill dirt that moved easily, and so the job overall was easier. But the reason why we were doing this was to prune roots so that we could prune them in a clean manner, not in the dirt, and apply pruning paint to those roots to prevent it from being infected by like Ganoderma or other fungi. So I showed you a picture of this red oak from the top, but this was earlier, it was right next to the house. And so this tree was actually had co-dominant stems, and at some point this was pruned off and the decay was spreading. So not only did that tree get over pruned, but then it had this decay present at the base. So it was my recommendation the tree needed to be removed because of the risk associated with that. So this is a large hackberry or possibly a sugarberry that fell over. And we've had so much rain this past year that I think we're losing a lot of trees just because of the amount of rain. Likely that increased the risk of root rot. But as you can see, the root ball came up on this tree. But within a week's time, I had many clients with trees falling over like this. And so that's a shame. So again, with soil, a limited amount of soil can be bad. We see this often, trees planted in these little islands in the parking lot, and there's just no space for it. This tree was a trooper and basically filled that whole little island with roots. And so it's hard to see, but this is all roots, all through here. And it even grew around the fire hydrant. And so they were, this commercial property, they had a lot of trees on the property that needed to be removed. for other reasons, but this is going to be very difficult to grind the roots of a of this just because of the fire hydrant and everything. So weather. One of the weather issues is sunlight. Sunlight can be bad for trees, which is a little hard to believe, but bark, trees that have thin bark can be susceptible to sun scald, especially when the tree becomes used to not receiving as much sun, and then suddenly that changes. Commonly, that's associated with a tree that's new, that was grown in a nursery where it was grown very densely with other trees and then planted out into the landscape, and then that bark is not acclimated to the sunlight. In this case, at this property, the security department for the company could not see with their cameras as well, so they had the trees lifted, the canopies raised dramatically, and there was probably 50 trees that had large wounds like this from sun scald. These are red oaks, maples, they're all very susceptible to sun scald. This isn't my picture, fortunately, but just to show you kind of some bad things that can happen. This is probably from a tornado. But we definitely have ice storms here. Fortunately, we did not get, we haven't had one yet this year, and hopefully we don't. I think it was 2010 or 11, we had our last major ice storm that we can still see evidence of in our older trees from that damage. Bottom right picture, you see how one of our climbers is out there on the ends of those branches trying to reduce the weight out there and do some structural pruning so that those trees can better withstand themselves in those ice storms. Wind damage, something that we see commonly here. This is another Bradford pear. Lightning. So lightning is very frequent. Typically hits the tallest tree in that particular given area. This is a cottonwood tree that is very tall, taller than the other trees in the area. This tree actually has Ganoderma growing at the base as well. Has this large wound. This is kind of at the ground level looking up. The tree has a huge lean to it as well over a creek and a hike and bike path. Unfortunately, the homeowner wasn't willing to consider removal, even though it was recommended because of the hazardous nature of the tree. There's a lot of trees along Lake Texoma that I've seen that have been hit by multiple lightning strikes, and they survive and heal from it. It just depends on how fast they can seal those wounds before a wood decaying fungus or pathogen gets into that tree. So it's always a positive sign to see this callus tissue develop on the side. But it's a matter of time. Is the tree healthy enough to seal that wound? And in this case, I don't think it is based on the canopy is dying. There's large dead, limbs that are like this big up in the canopy. And so that's just that large dead branches in the canopy makes it risky too. This is a pine tree over in Irving on our commercial property that you can see the damage from the lightning strike. So I'm almost done, but I encourage you to have your trees inspected regularly by a certified or consulting arborist. And I'll take questions now, but on our website, there's an area where you can send questions to me, and it just comes in via email to me, and you can attach pictures and stuff. So And if I get busy, please have a little patience, but if this spring, we're gonna get some other arborists to help me answer all these questions that we expect to come in this spring. So, thank you.